Good morning. If you don't already have a seat, if you would please take one. We'll start in about 5 seconds. Good morning. Welcome to the Center for Global Development. I'm Lawrence McDonald. I work here. I see some old friends in the audience, old friends of mine, and I trust there's some old friends of Lant. Some of you may know a lot about the Center for Global Development. I'm wondering, is there anybody here who's never been here before? Okay, good. Well, I'm glad you raised your hand, because that gives me an excuse to tell you a little bit about the Center for Global Development. I thought, oh my goodness, if like nobody raises their hand, I'll really be stuck. We are a think and do tank, and we have an unusual mission in the development space, which is to hold a mirror up to the rich and powerful and try to identify ways that they could do things differently that would make it less difficult for poor people to escape from poverty. As part of that, as the world changes and the definition of who is rich and powerful changes to include at least some element of people in the emerging powers, we're grappling with what that means for us. And part of grappling with that is the fact that Lant Pritchett, who's an old friend of the center's and friend of mine, while he is spending 2 years in India, is also with us as a senior fellow. And so we're kind of pushing the boundaries of our mission, really, and what it means to be a center dedicated to afflicting the powerful and comforting the afflicted. So that's a bit about CGD. Now, I don't want to preempt the next speaker who's going to introduce Lant, but I do want to tell one brief story about him. I had the privilege to know Lant when we were both a little bit younger and working at the World Bank and the Policy Research Department. And I had the good luck to ride on the same Orange Line train that he did. And every time I saw him, I would say, "So Lant, what are you working on?" And I was always fascinated and surprised. And so I'm sure that whatever he has to say to you today is going to be worthwhile. It's our pleasure to be co-hosting today's event with the David M. Kennedy Center for International Development at Brigham Young University. Thank you very much for bringing us this opportunity. It's terrific to be part of this effort to honor Lant. And it's now my pleasure to welcome Jeff Ringer, who is the director of the David M. Kennedy Center for International Development. Jeff.
Thank you, Lawrence. Let me first say how grateful we are to CGD for co-hosting this event for us today. They have something we don't, which is a presence in DC, so thanks very much. It's good to be here. The David M. Kennedy Center, and I should explain, it's not the Kennedy family that is particularly well known in these parts. It is David M. Kennedy, who was Secretary of the Treasury in the Nixon administration in the 1970s, later ambassador to NATO. And a Utah native who lent his name to the Kennedy Center at BYU. The center was established about 30 years ago in an attempt to focus on what we think is one of the unique strengths of BYU, that is the international experience of our student body, and to capitalize on that. For 30 years, we've been awarding a Distinguished Service Award to alumni and friends of the university who have made particularly significant contributions to understanding global affairs. And this year we're very proud to present this award to Professor Lant Pritchett. I suspect Lant needs little introduction to this crowd, but please indulge me for just a moment. Lant earned his BA in economics at BYU and then a PhD in economics at MIT. And during a career which spans the World Bank, Harvard School of Government, and CGD, Lant has established himself as one of the preeminent voices in development economics. Whether it's challenging the conventional wisdom or providing new ways to look at old problems, he is, as a New York Times Magazine profile called him, a practiced iconoclast and an economist who has spent his career puncturing other people's panaceas. He was involved in some of the most important reports produced at the World Bank and is the author or co-author of over 50 papers, as well as the 2006 book, Let Their People Come. I understand he has another book at the press right now. His Harvard bio reads in part, "Lant, an American national, was born in Utah in 1959 and raised in Boise, Idaho. Perhaps because of this," I find that an intriguing phrase, "perhaps because of this, he has worked in or traveled to over 40 countries and has lived in three other countries, Argentina, Indonesia, and India. as someone who has followed the reverse migratory pattern of being born and raised elsewhere and now living in Utah, I suspect there may be a message in there for me. At any rate, I'm very pleased to recognize Professor Lant Pritchett this morning and present him with the Distinguished Service Award. Would you join me, please?
What that consists of, to be more explicit, is that the Mormon Church encourages its youth to serve two-year proselyting missions abroad. So BYU has one of the most internationally experienced student bodies in the world because you get people who've actually lived for 2 years, many of them in places that not lots of other Americans live. I actually served a Mormon mission in Argentina, Cordoba region, and a lot of kind of what I think about development started very early in watching what happened in Argentina at the time, which was 1978. I'll admit my age with this gray hair. It's no longer, I either had to change the color of my hair or admit my age, so I'll just admit my age. I was there from 78 to 80 and, you know, saw things that thought, wow, this really is different. This is worth understanding, and went from there to BYU economics, to MIT economics, to then making a career of worrying about a different take on the problems. I'm honored and pleased to sort of come the full circle and contribute back to BYU and back to a different sort of mission. Now, I have almost exactly the wrong presentation, I think, for this audience. I thought it would be more BYU students and less kind of development professionals. So this is going to be way more controversial than I meant it to be, because students wouldn't maybe understand just how controversial what I was saying is, whereas, you know, with people in the room like Catherine Marshall and Darius Manns and Maureen Lewis, they know just how controversial what I'm saying is. So fortunately, I see on the running schedule that if I stick to a 40-minute presentation, we'll have 23 minutes for questions and answers, which should be plenty of time for pushback. So I want to talk about what I'm deeply, deeply, deeply worried about the course of development. And as we all know, we're entering, in some sense, there's a definitive date around which we're entering a third era of development. The first era of development I call the Pax Americana. The Americans basically dominated the international agenda. They dominated the creation of the trading regime. They dominated the creation of the IMF. They dominated sort of geopolitically in view of a Cold War. And hence, they also were very influential in setting up the World Bank and in some sense intellectually in development. And their sort of the interests of the Pax Americana was really national development. And I'll get back to a little bit what I mean by that more, but it was really about nation states. It was about what was happening to the nation states that had emerged from World War II, what was happening to the nation states that were newly independent after World War II. It was a national development. Now, after the end of the Cold War, there was a really, I think we haven't acknowledged yet how deep the shift has been and from the Pax Americana view of development to the sort of MDG view of development. And I regard it as an almost, well, it's an ontological shift. It's really a very deep shift. And the big question is, what comes next? So what do I mean by an ontological shift? Well, kind of what you mean by development is something becoming more like itself while staying itself, right? It meaning, you know, an egg becomes a frog, and it may look very different at various stages of its development from egg to frog, but all along its fundamental frogness is present. It's not an egg becoming a rock or an egg becoming a nation state. It's an egg becoming a frog. So development is not about things changing their ontological natures, right? So we're really now in a sort of, there's two kind of ontologically different definitions of development, meaning what's developing? What is it that's developing? One view is that development is a description of a fourfold transformation in rule systems, and they're rule systems of a society. So if you ask yourself, what's the ontological nature of the kind of thing that has institutions? Well, people don't have institutions. People participate in institutions. A society has institutions, right? And so, and we, I avoid the word institutions wherever possible, so I come up with even worse names like rule systems, and kind of what happened to the countries that were developed and hence defined what development meant in 1960 or 1950 is they had a transformation in the rule systems in four different dimensions. A rule systems that governed the economy, that moved from smaller scale to larger scale, in rules that governed the polity, from basically subject to citizen, in rules that govern the administration of organizations, from sort of small and informal and personalistic to Weberian, and rules that govern the interaction between individuals and society, from your relationships being conditioned by your conditions of birth to more equality of treatment of people, so that you were less conditioned how I treated people on their conditions of their birth. And this is kind of so there were four domains of this transition that all happened, and I draw squiggly lines because we don't really know that these all happened at a linear pace or that one preceded the other. But over time, you know, what happened in the United States and Denmark and Japan and other places that were regarded in 1960 as developed is they got a more productive economy by a transition essentially from pre-modern economy to what we called a modern economy. And towards a more responsive polity. So the rule systems for how power was exercised by the sovereign went from control by one or few to control by citizens, and we have a variety of adjectives to describe those transitions. And we moved to more capable administrations. So there was a rise of the Weberian bureaucracy. We had large organizations that behaved themselves according, and individuals in those organization behave themselves according to organizational specific rule systems. And we a huge transitions towards more equal societies. So rather than your sex, kith, clan, race being the key determinative of your role in society, we moved at least prospectively and hopefully towards kind of the individual was expected to be treated equally and freely no matter how you were born. And that was a historical transformation that happened. And it happened not in lots of places, but in some places. And it happened just massively and definitively. So just massive changes in all of these rule systems, such that the previous rule systems sort of became withered away. Let's not get into that. Okay, so now, what I want to call robust development is what happens to the society or maybe the country. And society and country, nation state is a very complicated thing because not all nations are states and not all states necessarily are nations. So I'm going to kind of be a little bit ambivalent about that, but mostly we measure things at country level. So when we go to measurement, we revert to the country, but we really mean a society. And it's this fourfold development. So kind of if I were measuring what development meant, I would measure where your society is as society. Not merely as aggregation of individual, but as society in the transformation in these four rule systems, economy, polity, administration, and equality. And I have to use the word equality because I can't use the word society twice, so I don't know what to call it, social or something. Okay. Now, there's this other definition that's commonly used when we go to metrics of development, but which is ontologically different, which is indicators of individuated well-being, where we start from the individual and say, how much income does the individual have? How much education does the individual have? And we can aggregate these individuated indicators of human well-being to the same units as these, but it doesn't make them the same. So we can say, what's the average level of education in a country? But the average level of education of a country is not a it's fundamentally about the individual. It just happens to be aggregated. As opposed to this, which is fundamentally ontologically about a society, or about an economy, or about a polity. Okay? Now, the first the first phase of development, and by which most people, when they say that, they mean, this is what I learned in graduate school. but the first phase of development was really about nation states. You know, what it really meant was modernization. Development was just another different way of saying we're going to accelerate the modernization process, where the modernization process is described as this fourfold transformation, and we're going to accelerate this fourfold transformation. And development efforts were really keyed on nation states, and probably way too much. Meaning, due to the Cold War politics and the sort of politics of why the advanced countries were advancing development, they were a little tolerant of, if they thought they were gaining in terms of the capability of the nation state, and if they thought the nation state was doing okay, they were a little less concerned if that led to individuated well-being. So, meaning, if they had a nation state that was ordered and capable of, say, maintaining order within its boundaries and keeping the communists out, kind of if that didn't lead to too much well-being for people, that was okay by us, meaning us meaning Americans, and you don't have to include yourself in that us if you don't want to. Okay. So now what happened is the Pax Americana view of development kind of died with the Cold War, because all the real politic types in America that kind of cared about development as an instrument to keeping these newly developed countries out of the ambit of the Soviet Union kind of evaporated when the Soviet Union evaporated. So whatever U.S. interests they had in Angola and some civil war in Angola, because maybe one side called itself Marxist and one side didn't, poof, we really don't care. So the reaction to that was that, well, now we have less support for development, so we need a new political economic basis on which to sell development to people we want to support it. And to some extent, the MDGs were the defining sort of response to this, but it was a reaction to the loss, both to the failures of state-led and state-centric development, but also to the loss of kind of interest. And it was thought it would shore up the political support by putting more emphasis on individuated well-being, more emphasis on ameliorating or mitigating the very low indicators of those indicators of well-being, and on concentrating on sector-specific issues which had a rich country base. So let's appeal to more support for rich countries on a different basis than let's not let them go communist. Let's actually help, say, people in these countries. But once you were competing on a concern basis, it went more towards this, right? So let me give you an example. So dollar-a-day poverty. Dollar-a-day poverty, in my view, is one of the craziest things that has ever happened. It's just absurd. It's absurd. And yet, it has become this dominant construct. And so I have to explain to you both why it's absurd and why, in spite of its absurdity, it's become the dominant construct, right? Well, first of all, it's absurd because, you know, a dollar a day is $365 a year. It's $14.60 for a family of four, which means one person working at 70 cents, 5 cents an hour could provide that level of consumption for a family of four. 75 cents an hour. That's our threshold at which we're no longer going to regard people as being poor. Really? How did we come by such an incredibly penurious standard above which, by the way, you're not poor, hence from our objective of eliminating global poverty, you no longer count? Well, kind of I mean, first thing to point out is that all of these things are at least an order of magnitude lower than what's tolerated in any really developed country. So the federal minimum wage, which is incredibly penurious by any developed country standards, the U.S. federal minimum wage is like $6.75 an hour, right? The actual wage of an unskilled worker in the U.S. is more like $11 an hour. So we're talking order of magnitude higher at the lowest possible threshold in the U.S. than what we say is the threshold above which you're not poor. Okay? The second, the really crazy thing about poverty is that if you say poverty is my objective, and then you think how much has my objective been incremented by increases in income, you're actually asserting that my objective has not been advanced. Zero, exactly zero, has been advanced by increases in income above the poverty line. Okay? Now, we might say that represents, say, and I'll use a little jargon, the marginal utility of an individual. That individual's marginal utility of income declines as they get richer, and kind of zero is a good approximation of people's marginal utility of income as it passes a dollar a day. That's a completely ludicrous characterization of human beings, human behavior, human choices, human anything, right? I mean, after all, if you think about it, if your marginal utility of income was really zero to a dollar a day, your labor supply would fall a lot, right around dollar a day. We don't see that. We don't see people going, oh, dollar a day, well, I'm going to take more days off. You know, people work 40 hours a week, right up to $10,000, you know, right up to $10 a day, right up to $100 a day. It gets way, you're talking a dollar a minute before you might think people's marginal utility as elicited by their own choices is anywhere near zero. So this is just, in my mind, a crazy characterization of how human beings actually value their own increments to income. So somehow we've superimposed on what people actually say about what their marginal utility of income is, a poverty construct that says, no, you're wrong about that. To us, you know, at zero or maybe a dollar a day or maybe even $2 a day, the increment to the global poverty objective of your gains in income, boom, disappears, goes to exactly zero. It's, you know, analytically, it's just really crazy. And again, I know that's shocking to many people in the room who've talked a lot about dollar a day, thought a lot about a dollar a day, have a lot of propaganda about dollar a day, probably sitting out on the shelves.
Not here.
good. So, you know, but really, once you accept a dollar a day, you know, economy-wide productivity, which is accomplished by a transformation in rule systems that make more productive activities possible, becomes less relevant than within a given distribution of income, say for a poor country or a middle-income country or a rich country. First of all the kind of, if you really take a dollar a day standard, all the even modestly middle-income countries, there's no poverty in those countries at all. Poverty, literally just poverty just disappears because the distribution, you know, there literally is no dollar a day poverty in the United States by any measure, you know. After all, when we talk about there being 20% poverty in the United States, it's on a $15 a day standard that we start to get measures of poverty in the United States. So a dollar a day, no one's there. And moreover, you start to think that what I call, and I don't, no, I do. I was going to say I don't mean this to be pejorative, but I do. You start to get kinky development, right? In the sense that development is no longer kind of these distribution of income shifting up, kind of, but we can go and we can kink the development by just bringing the bottom up, and then we've somehow solved the development problem by kinking up the distribution of income through, say, targeted transfers. And so the whole context of what development means and is gets shifted, right? Now, you know, from, and, you know, people can, serious people can write books that have subtitles like A Radical Rethinking of Poverty that don't talk about any of the things that actually reduce poverty. Because what really reduces poverty, everywhere that poverty has been sustainably reduced, it's because the country got more productive. Full stop. And programs typically have really small lasting impacts. And again, it's not that they don't have impacts, and it's not you can't make transfers that do reduce consumption poverty, but in terms of, you know, as long as you make the transfer, it continues when you stop making the transfer. And when we look at really effective programs at, you know, helping poor people, they have percentage point-like increases on income. And that's a huge success, and I'm all in favor of it. But let's not kid ourselves that this is this. And let's not kid ourselves that this is really about transforming the places where people work, not the people. And let me just meet what I mean by that is the worst kind of mistake to make in thinking about poverty is to think that poverty is about poor people, that there's this group of people called the poor, and that they have conditions that make them poor, and hence ameliorating poverty is addressing the conditions that cause the poverty of individuals. That may be true in some super rich countries in which there's super high productivity, and hence the poverty of the poor is the result of their not taking advantage of the opportunities they have. But in most of the world, you're poor because of where you live. And this is most clearly illustrated by migration. So with Michael Clemens from CGD and Claudio Montenegro from the bank, we did a study for 40 countries around the world where we just compared, you know, observationally equivalent individuals, meaning here's a male, 35 years old, born in Haiti, educated in Haiti, 9 years of schooling. What does that, you know, statistically identical person make if they're still in Haiti versus they're in the United States? So what happened to the person? They moved the place in which they were working. So if their wages were about the personal productivity, their wages should remain unchanged. If their wages were about the place, their wages should change to the wages of the place. What happens? Nearly complete change to the wage of the place. So if that person is working in Haiti, they make 80 cents an hour. If that person works in that same observational equivalent person works in the United States, they make $8.25 an hour. So their wage income goes up tenfold, not because anybody taught them anything, not because they acquired any skills, not because they got more capability, not because they got microcredit, not because they were, you know, empowered, just because they moved to a productive place, right? So most of the inequality in the world is driven by the fact that exact same people are trapped in unproductive places versus productive places. So if you say, let's look at 100 Haitians in the world who aren't poor. How did they do that? Well, most of the Haitians in the world who aren't poor are in the United States. And if you go to the Haiti and try to make people in Haiti less poor while keeping them in Haiti, it's a very tough road to hoe. Because they're trapped in perverse rules systems of the society and place they're in. Okay? So, and I shouldn't have to say this, but another way of sort of thinking about the poverty issue is that the rich in poor countries are actually much poorer than the poor in rich countries. So work I'm doing with Marla Spivak here. We're just looking, and this audience, I could show PPP and you might believe it, but most people, you show PPP and they have no idea that there's no like intuitive, like PPP income of the 90th percentile in Haiti versus, you know. Okay, so what we do is we just take the share of your food, the share of your budget you spend on food. Everywhere and always in the world, richer people spend less on food than poorer people. Everywhere and always, right? So here is the food share from richest, from poorest percentile to richest percentile in the United States, which goes from about 15 down to about 10. And by the way, this includes food spent in restaurants. I mean, food spent at home goes down even further in the United States. So the poorest people in the United States spend about 15% of their income on food. The poorest people, say, in India spend about 60% of their budget on food. But the richest people in rural areas of India, the 95th percentile in rural India, spend 45% of their income on food. So, you know, the problem isn't like that the poor in India are poor. The problem is the rich in India are poor. And the rich in India are poor because they're in an unproductive place. Same graph for Indonesia. You know, food share falls, but of the richest people in rural Indonesia, they're spending 35% of their income on food, which is more than double the food share of the poorest people in America. And this is true, we've done this for lots and lots of countries. This is true for any European country. The average food share of people at the poverty line in Europe is 15%. And in no country that is lower middle income does the food share of the rich get below 30%. So it's double. Okay. So let me give you a second example of what I call defining development down, which is we're going to take the problem of development and we're going to redefine development as being about just the lower end of specific indicators as opposed to be about the whole transformation of the system. So, you know, the MDG on education, and I put education in quotes, because really it's just about completing primary school, right? So the goal at which presumably development had been achieved was like completing primary school. So first of all, you have to ask yourself, and I hate using this, but I do it all the time. But anyway, you have to ask yourself, really? Really? We think someone who completes primary school today at age 10, they're going to be in the workforce for 50 years, which means they're going to be in the workforce in 2053. And if you try and think back what you knew when you finished primary school. Like, I knew the capital of Idaho and some other states. I do, right? And I'm really equipped for the life that's going to confront me with just primary completion. That was our development goal? And then secondly, what if you're not learning much? Oh, oops. In this goal of schooling, we forgot to specify that you would actually learn anything while in school. So if you complete, you know, if your butt stays in the seat for 5 years, you have met our only metric by which we have defined what would be accomplished through development, right? Now, this is a complicated graph, but for this audience, it's not too complicated. If you look at the distribution of scores of kids in Denmark and kids in Tamil Nadu, which is where I'm now living, and which is, by the way, one of the better states of India, what you'll see is that, you know, the whole distribution of learning, and this is of kids who are in 8th grade, so these are the kids in India that have persevered through the system, the whole distribution is just massively shifted. So the absolute top end of kids in Tamil Nadu is barely reaching the average of kids in Denmark. The average kid in Tamil Nadu, if they were in Denmark, they would actually be they'd be in remedial classes, frankly. They'd be in the bottom 10%. So the average kid in Tamil Nadu at the same, you know, grade level is just unbelievably low relative to the distribution of performance in kids in Denmark. And basically there's nobody in the upper tail. If we say who's in the global top 10%, well, Denmark has about 6% of its kids in the global top 10%. And Tamil Nadu, basically, we can't measure it in any way that it, I know it's not exactly zero. I know there's some kid in Tamil Nadu in the top 10%, but there's no way you can measure this that just isn't exactly zero. So the point is that the problem with education systems isn't that kids aren't getting into school, and isn't even that poor kids are getting a poor education. Rich kids are getting a terrible education. So this is a graph from Dion Filmer. Yeah, good. I'm glad. I like to at least cite people sometimes. That shows the scores, you know, on a examination that by definition has OEC mean of 100 and OECD standard deviation of OECD mean of 500, student standard deviation of 100. You know, even kind of what we think of as upper middle income countries like Mexico, the median student is like at four, is just barely above 400, right? The rich students in Mexico, the average of the richest quintile in Mexico is like 480. So the richest kids in Mexico are getting an education that leaves them well below the average kid in the United States. Now, let's just remind ourselves that no one in this room was anywhere near the average kid. The average kid in the United States is not very well educated. The average kid in the United States plays 26 hours a week of video games. The average kid in the United States, you know, is not graduating from a super elite college. So the point is that the richest in these countries aren't achieving the average of the OECD. The problem, yes, there's a problem that the poor get a worse education than the rich, but the problem is the average puts them at, you know, bottom of the U.S. distribution. So again, you know, really? That was, you know, I'm Mexico. I wanted to find my goal as everybody completing primary school. Well, thank you very much. I did that like 20 years ago. And I would think my problem is, you know, I still am not getting very much learning out of my system, but there's no place for that in the goals. So I think, and this is, gets even more controversial, there's a real problem with the divergence of views about the world and what's important between the elite of the elite and the middle of the middle. So I'm going to show a couple of graphs based on the World Value Survey that has been going on and been done in lots of countries around the world, and it asks people about your values about various things and asks questions like, would you prefer this and that? And from that, Engelhart, who is one of the main program, has constructed indices of your post-materialism. And post-materialism is kind of how much do you want income from your job and how much do you want self-expression from your job? How much do you want your job to allow you to have freedom and autonomy, and how much do you really care about the wage? So there's materialism versus post-materialism. And not surprisingly, if you look at the post-materialist attitudes, they're like massively higher for people with higher education. Right? It's kind of why people like us got good educations, right? So we wouldn't actually have to work every day really hard just to make enough money to feed ourselves. We could both kind of make enough money and be doing interesting stuff, right? So the elites, and by the way, this has been trending always, but massively trends towards post-materialism, especially among the educated elite, okay? And if you look by country at how they regard traditional versus secular sort of values and survival versus self-expression values, which is the same as this post-materialism index, basically, in the rich countries, you're up in this block, and in the poor countries, you're down in this block. You're very, very little, you're much more concerned with survival than self-expression, and you're much more amenable to having traditional structure of authority than kind of rational secular structure of authority. So, the development discourse, who do you think dominates it? People up here, people who are both in elite countries and have elite educational status within those countries. Their values are very, very different, in part because their materialist circumstances are completely different. If you ask me, you know, how much harder do you want to work for an additional unit of money? Well, I kind of have a lot of money. And if you ask me, how much harder would I work if you give me something really interesting to do? I'd work a lot harder because I'm short on interest, long on money. Inshallah, I should say something like, grace be to God, right? Something. Now, if you look at GDP per capita and the share of the people who are post-materialist, what you see is that post-materialism, and again, just remind yourself that dollar a day is 1,460 a year, or 365 a year per person. This is 10,000 GDP per capita, right? So this is way, way, way beyond any poverty level. Basically, there's almost no increase in post-material values till you get very, very high levels of income. Then post-materialism starts to go up. The U.S. tends to, Did I cover the U.S. up with the graph? I may have covered the U.S. up. The U.S. might be over here. And I covered it up with an opaque box. But basically, post-materialism, that is, the view that kind of broad-based increases in income don't really matter a lot, kind of is a view that develops very, very late. Meaning 30,000 per capita GDP, not 20,000, not 10,000. It starts, you know, it starts to go up naturally. As you get richer, you value non-material things more. But it goes way up. Now, what's very worrisome, oh, man, I'm getting more controversial as I go. Okay. The next slide's even worse. No, they're not the next slide. I'm going to come back to these slides. Okay. Now let's stratify post-materialism, and let's compare kind of self-reported class of Canadians and their post-materialism versus self-reported class of Indians and their post-materialism. And what you find is that the elite Indians, who in a survey say, what class am I? I'm upper class. We're only 72, so it's not like a huge, this is something like, this is only like 3%, well, I'm guessing now, 700, 500. This is well less than 10% of the respondents. They actually have post-materialism views that look a lot like Canada. They're actually more post-materialist than the upper class in Canada. Okay? So the elites of countries often kind of adopt the values of the elites of the world because they want to be seen as elites of the world. And if elites of the world think this, well, geez, that must be the cutting edge thing to think, so I'll go along with what the elites of the world think. And this, we've sort of, we're looking at this for more countries. So there's this thing in which, you know, there's this debate that's going to go on about the importance of development versus development. This is a development versus development. And there are two perfectly legitimate definitions of development. One is about, you know, individuated well-being, and one is about kind of systems and overall kind of countrywide things. And my argument is the elite of the elite have been lending themselves, in part because they're predominated by post-materialist values, by a view in which development is becoming just something that matters to the poorest of the poor. And, you know, our primary modifier on consumption, like with our first adjective, we express what we think is most important. And how do we modify consumption? Sustainable, right? What's the word you see most often linked with consumption in these discussions? Sustainable. Well, I think the middle of the middle. Everybody's making a big deal that India is now a middle-income country, and I live in India, so the middle-income person in India defecates outdoors. The middle-income person in India has no toilet facility. Not a latrine, not an indoor flush toilet, none. So this is 80% of rural Indians have no toilet facility in 2006. This isn't like 1980. This is like 2006. Okay? You know, the United States, 1945, immediate post-war, we still had something like less than 30% of the population that had no toilet facility. And today, I mean, it's, yeah, you can't do it, right? Literally. Won't be allowed to live in a house that doesn't have a toilet facility, so it just disappeared. And even in urban India, only slightly less than 50% of people have any toilet facility. Any, yeah.
Is that self-designated, or are you
basically what?
Reported consumption? How are you deciding? How do you
figure? No, no, this is from the national, this is from the NFHS. And they ask people a five-tiered question about their toilet facilities, flush toilet. It's a five-tiered thing, and one of the options is none. So this is, You know, they didn't answer latrine, they didn't answer, flush toilet, they didn't answer any outhouse, they just none. Which, I walk around Chennai, I ground truth this sometimes. the middle of the middle, even in a middle, I said the middle of the middle, because this is the middle of what India is now being regarded as a middle-income country. So the middle of the middle doesn't have a toilet. That's a pretty pressing materialist concern, and I might sacrifice some post-materialist concerns in order to address my materialist concerns, right? I have other statistics about, I'm presenting these in part because people have this wild, and especially in the United States, have this wild kind of view of what's really happening in India. But, the fraction of Indians that have a car, and this is a little old, this is 2004, the fraction of Indians with a car is 2%. 2%, right? A level that probably the United States had before they invented the car was probably the last time we had 2% of Americans with a car. Just any kind of indicator you want. the median rural household in India uses firewood for fuel to cook their food. So people, all the time I hear people say, well, India, why are we worried about India? They're a middle-income country. Really? The median person in the middle-income country uses firewood. So I think there's a big debate between kind of the view that development will be addressed by targeting the poor, by programmatic interventions, by worrying about the effectiveness of specific interventions, and let's have evidence-based adoption of interventions proven to work, versus actually worrying about broad-based gains, system fixes, the effectiveness of state organizations, the representativeness of the polity, the equality of the society, the capable of the overall administration, and the productivity of the economy. And I think the middle of the middle are still worried that they're living in countries without representative, without responsive polities, without capable administrations, without productive economies, and where inequality by order condition of birth is still a massive problem. And you might argue that the way to solve these problems is through these kinds of things, but I would think you would have a very, very tough row to hoe. You would have a very tough row to hoe that would say, focusing on this specific indicator of what's happening to the bottom of the bottom is the way to fix the fact that the police force just doesn't work for anybody. Or focusing on getting, bribing poor parents to get their kids into bad schools is the way to fix the fact that even the elite of the country are in really crappy schools. I could concoct such an argument because I'm smart. I can concoct about an argument for about anything. But you'd have a tough time, I think, sustaining it. So there's three kinds of ways to think about development, right? One is we move due east, and we hope that leads north. We're going to focus on overall problems like economic growth, improving the quality of democracy, improving the capability of the state, to respond and do what it needs to do, improving kind of the overall social transformation, and if we go this way, we'll go that way. Right? The other is that we move due north, right? So we take some indicator of well-being, like a specific disease or maybe education, and we try and say, well, we can't really fix all that, so we're just going to try and fix this one thing. Right? So we move the distribution for everybody this way. And the other is kind of kinky development. We'll just bring up the bottom. We won't worry about the whole society and economy, or the whole society and country moving that way. And we won't even necessarily worry about fixing the whole system. We'll just bring the distance from which the poor in this situation are from the rich in this situation a little bit better. We'll have targeted programs to have access to healthcare for the poor. So India right now is huge on access of the poor. Turns out nobody in India wants to go to the public system. So that's where I'm going to stop, because the rest of it was going to be about the difficulties of the US political in that, but I think that's a second order issue relative to this big issue. Am I about on time, Lawrence? I saw you looking at your watch, so either.
No, I was just looking because it looked like you were wrapping up. I wasn't keeping track.
Okay. Am I about on?
It's 10:30.
Was that where I was supposed to stop?
I was so engrossed in your lecture, I look at my cheat sheet.
Man, oh man, you should work in communications.
You've got 5 more minutes.
Okay, so I'm going to take those 5 minutes, and instead of having 23 minutes of Q&A, we'll have 28 minutes of Q&A, because I think we can talk a little bit about the U.S. politics, but it's too depressing, because basically, as we all know, there's almost nobody on the Hill for whom development's a voting issue. Almost little or no broad-based constituency for development among American voters. Our security apparatus has only instrumental concerns, which is like, we broke it, can you fix it? Referring to Afghanistan, say. I mean, they thought, oh, well, we broke this country, we'll turn it over to development experts and you can fix it now and then we can leave. So they're only interested in development as far as it can kind of deliver in circumstances they care about, right? The foreign policy apparatus isn't really that convinced that development, broad-based development, really serves American interests anymore, because there's as much hand-wringing about the fact that China and India are being successful as there is celebration of the fact that they're being successful, and the fact that Egypt was the major recipient of U.S. aid for 20 years clearly didn't do any good as. Didn't buy us very many hearts and minds in the long run. And so they're very skeptical. And basically, the now who dominates the development discourse in the United States is kind of philanthropic concerns from the left and the right. And I'm not quite sure what I mean by that, but anyway. But, there's a strong tendency that the discussions and the debate are dominated by philanthropic interests, by which they mean, I have X million dollars, what can I most do to promote individuated well-being with that X million dollars, and that's what I mean by development. And that's a perfect, if you have X million dollars, again, God bless you, but if you have if you have X million dollars and want to spend it, that might be the right framing of the issue, but it's not the framing of the development issue. It's a framing of what I always call this maximizing development conditional on development. How can I get the most human well-being given that I haven't had development in the traditional sense? And that's a legitimate concern, but it's not a development concern. And if you get confused about that, you give up on the underlying development concern. So I think the U.S. is going to be a leader of this and is very small. So I think over the next 2 years, I hope at least there's a healthy debate between the elite of the elite and the middle of the middle. Or the post-2015 agenda, is it really going to include the concerns of the middle of the income distribution Indonesia and the middle of the income distribution India and the middle of the income distribution person in Ecuador? Or is it going to be kind of, let's define the poverty agenda in such a way that the absolutely ridiculously small amounts of what we call development assistance can solve the problem as we've defined it? So let's define development down so far that $150 billion in foreign assistance can solve it, which is kind of how the MDGs were driven, in my view. As we said, how much money can we really spend? What can we accomplish with that money? Let's set those goals so that it's roughly commensurate. Okay, that I think was sufficiently controversial, and we can start with questions.
Do next. And are there key examples in the back of your mind of where donors or philanthropists have actually succeeded in changing these rule-based systems? Aside from, because the main example you give right now is people leaving the rule-based systems to come to our rule-based systems.
Well, if I had to name three things, right? A, infrastructure. What the middle of the middle cares about is building infrastructure. And, I was talking to the guy who heads the Chinese aid agency. And it came up that I had worked at the World Bank. And he just said, can you explain to me why the World Bank hasn't been building infrastructure in Africa? And it was like, I could, but it'd be embarrassing. So infrastructure. B, policing. Core competencies of core public responsibilities. We've been ignoring, you know, part of the danger of this approach is that if you say, I'm going to have a project, and while I do a project, I'm going to build the capability of the organization, it just doesn't work that way, right? So, as you know, I've been doing research about capability of state organizations, and even in countries that are making rapid economic progress, the measures seem to suggest that the capability of, like, delivering the mail, having a police force that enforces the law without corruption, having neutral and honest regulatory apparatus, just isn't making progress. So in India, the middle of the middle is really concerned about corruption, right? And in part, they're concerned about corruption because they're worried about a deterioration in the overall quality of the state to deliver on fundamental things like law and order, security, things like that. So state capability, delivering the mail. I would think of delivering the mail. How much donor attention is paid to delivering the mail, you know, having a police force that works. Third thing I would have you think about, obviously, is my new book, right? I'm an academic, too. my new book is about, you know, shifting the education agenda from schooling to learning, right? What the middle class care about is that their kid come out of schooling ready to get a high-paying and, you know, adequate job for the future. And that's a learning agenda. That's a skills agenda. That's a capabilities agenda. I mean, I'm not taking a narrow approach to our, you know, test-based. This isn't about test-based versus non-test-based. This is just, are we really focusing on developing the capabilities that people need to be, you know, competent adults? So that's a third issue where it's a complete shift, whereas right now a lot of the attention is to getting, you know, the last few people not in school in school. It's like, well, yeah, there's some girls in rural Mali that aren't in school, but lots of countries have 100% of kids in school and 90% of them learning not a whole hell of a lot. So there's three examples of how I think you'd shift the agenda, and it just leads to a whole different thinking of what would a program in this look like, right? What would a program of learning look like as opposed to, I mean, the idea that the World Bank sells the conditional cash transfers as the kind of innovation of the last decade just reveals how pathetic the thinking about what development has really gotten, that that can be regarded as a development intervention.
Hi, my name is Ben.
That's okay. Yeah, no, you're next.
I'm Wendy. I'm with the American Red Cross, and I work in advocacy, international advocacy.
Right.
So I want to first disabuse you of the notion that everyone in this room went to an elite school, because I did not. I went to a Southern University, and its primary focus was the health and well-being of a bulldog on the football field. So I'm proud
now
of that.
Now, let's not compete on that. I went to BYU.
Oh.
We care a lot about football,
about
too, right?
Yes,
don't
exactly.
Compete on caring about football here. Otherwise, we'll rise and shout, right?
Right, anyway,
go ahead.
Right. So I'll get away from that.
Yeah.
I have two quick questions.
And by the way, in the world scheme of things, you went to Georgia Tech? No, Georgia.
UGA. Sadly, no.
Georgia.
University of Georgia.
University of Georgia is like in the top 200 universities in the world.
I don't think when I was there.
I just think you're wrong. I mean, really, seriously, right. We just underestimate how great American universities are. University of Georgia is better than any university in Africa, full stop.
I understand.
So globally, I always mean globally. Okay, go ahead. Sorry, that wasn't your real question.
Okay, just two quick things. Because I work in international advocacy, and the American Red Cross is very focused on disaster risk reduction.
Exactly.
And resilience. So I want to ask you about that connection to philanthropic concerns and how you see that also connecting to infrastructure development. And then if I could just revert quickly back to when you were comparing the poverty in different countries to the poverty level here in the United States.
Yeah.
I used to do domestic social safety net work.
Yeah.
And the federal poverty level, you know, for a family of four is 22 grand plus, you know. Were you making your calculations for poverty for comparison in your work based on the current FPL or the supplemental? Because, you know, I think you mentioned that the, you know, the largest piece of the pie for Americans is paying for food. And that, I don't know if I heard that correctly. And
no,
I just want to, it's just for my own edification. Thank you.
No, it's just, I mean, again, that last point kind of The answer is it doesn't really matter, meaning if I take the poverty line of any rich country, it's tenfold above dollar a day or two, even mostly. I mean, in Europe, it's all way. In Europe, the typical poverty line, which is measured as half the median, so it's a relative poverty line, is like at $30 a day, right? So the U.S. poverty line at 22,000, if you divide that by number of people in the household, it works out to be, last I worked it out was just a few years ago, you know, between $10 and $15 a day per person. Okay, but this is more, but more important is I want to address your point exactly, because I'm thinking of actually changing this from robust development to resilient development, which is, you know, countries that have gone a long way here, like, take care of their own disasters, right? So there was a, you know, there was an earthquake in Chile, and there was an earthquake in Haiti. Well, the one in Haiti, they didn't even have the capacity to import the capacity to fix it. So, you know, everybody said, well, we're going to avoid the domestic capacity because the domestic capacity is so weak in terms of capable administration, responsive polity, productive economy, that they can't handle their own earthquakes, so we donors will cocoon our relief efforts from these efforts. But the problem is if you never move this direction, that happens again and again and again. So what you don't want to be in the position of is saying, oh, we need to fix this problem for them in such a way, and I'm not saying the American Red Cross does, but I'm just saying, in general, you know, you gain resilience going this way, right? So when Chile had an earthquake, they cleaned it up because they had, you know, they're a developed country. They've actually moved a long ways this way. So they were resilient to lots of things. So rather than focus on the event, you got to move this way, right? And then eventually, you know, Red Cross and humanitarian resources flow from these kinds to these kinds, even when these people are hit by exactly the same shocks. So, you know, Hurricane Sandy, you know, the United States doesn't go asking anybody else for money or capacity or anything else, right? Because we're resilient, and we're resilient. And the point about resilience is that you're then resilient to lots of things. Earthquakes, you know, we have an earthquake, we have a drought, we have a flood, we have a this, we have a that, we have the other. We're still resilient because we have a capable, we got a lot of resources, we have a productive economy, we have a pretty capable administration, and you can complain about the American administration and not being so capable and FEMA kind of sitting on its ass too much. Oh yeah, we're taping, shoot, okay. but still, relative to Haiti, it's like a long ways this way. And so I got no problem with kind of focusing on this when it happens, but if you don't move this way, it's just a vicious circle.
Thank you.
Resilient, I think, is a better word, even than robust, though.
Thanks. I'm Ralph Brown, a professor of sociology at BYU and director of the International Development Minor there. Another hat I wear is the executive director of the Rural Sociological Society. So this is kind of the things we like to deal with. I have a question about your education metric. Is it accounting for the fact that the rich often send their children out of country for their education? And the reason I ask that is it implies different options that are not place-specific to the rich. And if place is the issue and where we need to focus in many respects, it allows the rich in poor countries to mitigate the effects of place by making them non-participants in it.
Yeah, exactly. But, you know, we want to be clear. See, the word rich is just as problematic as the word poor, and I'm trying to come back to this, right? Is... You know, distributions of income have a long right tail, right? So I like to call the difference between the statistical rich and the Fitzgerald rich, right? Fitzgerald has the famous line, you know, the rich aren't like you and me, they're different. Well, he means like the tail rich, right? The tail rich send their kids out, but this is the top 20%. So that's not the tail rich. And the top, I would guess the number of, you know, top 20% Indonesians who send their kids abroad at the high school level is inconsequential from a statistical average point of view. But I think the point you raise is very deep and is at the heart of the debates now in India, because what's happening in India is the middle class and above are essentially seceding from India. Like, they're saying, well, wait a second. I mean, and not to foreign schools, but to private schools. So in India today, I mean, a colleague of mine just did a, so an Indian constitution set up socialized medicine, right? We're going to provide every citizen of India with health care, and we're going to build clinics to do it, and da-da-da-da. And the heart of that was the MBBS-run primary health care. MBBS is a, master's in some, it's their doctor, okay? So a colleague of mine, Jishnu Das, did a very careful study of what's really going on in rural Madhya Pradesh, which is a typical, not particularly dysfunctional Indian state, and found of all the health-seeking visits, so when he asked people, did you have a health problem, what did you do about it? Of all the health-seeking visits, 3% went to the MBBS public clinic. So it's not that the poor, it's not that the rich aren't going to the clinics. The middle class aren't going to the clinics either. And then once the middle class aren't going, and neither are the poor, really. I mean, if it's down to 3%, neither are really the poor. But the point is, the fraction of Indian rural children, Indian urban children in private schools has crossed 50%. So again, it's not that the elite have opted out of the public schools. The middle class is increasingly opting out of the public schools. And then once they've opted out of public services, the whole dynamic of who's in favor of these structural transformations, who's really going to fight the fight of improving the health system, improving the education system, the whole political dynamic internally changes. And, strangely enough, the Indian government's response is to still, have targeted programs to provide vouchers for private sector services only to the poor, which maybe that's the right way back to having some functional system, but I don't know. So I think your concern, maybe not the opting out of the super rich into foreign, but the opting out, the increasing opting out of being deeply engaged with the state because I don't perceive that the state is doing anything for me, I think is a real problem. And programmatic efforts to address that, like we're going to come in with like this narrow slice approach of fixing particularly individual things for the poor, so the poor isn't a political platform in which you can like say, we're going to fix our systems. And again, not just on growth side, but on capability administration side, on responsibility of polity side, on the equality side. Other questions? Lawrence, I'll take three this time. Lawrence, Marine, and then that guy. And then I'll come to you two next.
Lan, thanks very much. I think you've made an important contribution. You've certainly stimulated my thinking. And I want to ask you to map onto these two views of development, one which I think of as the quite a modest one, which is the RCTs and conditional cash transfers.
I never said RCT. I tried really hard not to say RCT.
It's the conditional cash transfers then. It's the let's do what we can. It's a very modest approach. And maybe I'll say something about that modesty. I think that you grounded that approach in part on the values of the elites. But I think that another thing that's maybe motivating that is, whether it's modesty or humbleness or discouragement about the prospects of transforming other societies. And your own work on isomorphic mimicry suggests that, if you try to do big development, what you're calling robust development and really transform societies, the ability of outsiders to do anything about that is potentially quite limited. Yeah. But as I'm trying to think about those things, I wonder if you could try to map for us another set of paradigms that Bill Easterly has promoted between seekers and planners. Because I think a simple view would say, the seekers are doing the small development, doing what can be done around the margins, and the planners fall into the big, ambitious development. I suspect that's not your view, but I'd like you to untangle those two ideas for me.
That's a great question. Maureen, and then this guy.
Well, I've got sort of two unrelated questions, but one of the things that you seem to be talking about the middle as in the median rather than the middle class, correct?
Yes. Okay. I mean, when I usually say middle, I avoid the term class because only sociologists know what class means.
Okay, but, fair enough. But you do have a rising middle class.
Exactly.
In much of the world.
In much of the world.
And that changes the dynamic considerably. And the kinds of things you're talking about, I think, also get addressed in a sort of a strange way.
Right.
For one thing, I think middle class, in terms of having more money and having more time, that the paradigm shift is to worry about other things. And it's very interesting, in the elections last fall in Brazil, traditionally, voting has always been around jobs,
right,
and about income security, essentially. Now, it's about education and health, also with security on the end of it. But it's completely changed what people think is important, and it's moved them forward in a way that's very different than what the meeting would be. That was the first question. The second question is maybe a slip of tongue of by you.
Mm.
You made some comment about the need to promote democracy. And I don't know, you hadn't talked about before or after. And
It was a slip of the tongue.
It was a slip of the tongue, and you don't...
I mean, if I use the word democracy, it was a slip of the tongue.
Okay, I was assuming of that. So I will let that come.
I will explain to the rest of the audience why you and I might think it's a slip of the tongue versus a core thing. But
okay, all right, fine. Thank you.
Wade Jacoby at BYU in European Studies.
Uh-huh.
So the old story about development was fix the state, or at least part of it was fix the state, and in really, I think, in really interesting ways, you've gotten back to a lot of that right here. There's a lot of state fixing that needs to happen. And so the problem is that you've got two basic stories about how to do this, neither of which sounds super convincing given the complexity of the problem. One is sort of a wholesale importation of structures that seem to work somewhere else.
Right.
And the other is a kind of close-to-the-ground experimentalist approach that's really kind of organic and native in some way. But the problem is it doesn't aggregate very well. And in between, there's a kind of very set of very loose stories about how maybe you can have sort of plucky entrepreneurial types in country working with outsiders in some kind of strange coalition to make these things work. But those stories, you know, they tend to stay pretty vague. And I'm just curious to know if there's an alternative to those three approaches, or if one of them really is actually, as you look close to the ground, paying a lot more dividends than the other two, and we ought to really put more bets on that and move away from the other ones. Maybe that's related to the easterly question, I guess.
Yeah,
it is.
Okay, so let me combine kind of Lawrence's. So I think there were multiple sources of the abandonment of big development, right? One is like end of the Cold War. One is we tried. You know, we always said we were doing that. No one in development ever said we're not building capable organizations, but we failed, and we don't have an alternative theory, and so if we can't, then we won't, and then if we won't, let's not talk about it, right? And then, so one was kind of a lack of a theory. So I'm currently, right now, what I'm working on most recently is an approach called problem-driven iterative adaptation as a mechanism of building state capability. What?
Too long.
I know it's too long, but we shorten it to an acronym so people from the World Bank can love it still. but what it is precisely trying to say the kind of grassroots development doesn't work because it's not, in fact, often engaging with the mechanisms that could even, in some sense, possibly scale. So, like, you know, a really popular thing to do in the World Bank for a while has been community-driven development. Well, community-driven development kind of had two techniques. One is let's just take some money that went straight from the World Bank, some national-level organization, and drop it to some vaguely defined community that actually wasn't part of the governmentality of the country, right? I mean, and this was really apparent in India, where they have democratically elected village councils, and all the money flew? Flow all the money well. That was in Indonesia. In Indonesia, it flew, but that was a different story. In India, it flowed to these parallel structures. So we'd set up a water users group that had no permanent legal basis, but was just a project implementation mechanism that claimed it was ground up. But there was no plan as to how that would merge into governmentality, right? So I guess what we're thinking is we're trying to have seekers work in a way that can scale. So let's, instead of taking seekers outside the governmental system, let's actually try and get seeking behavior inside the governmentality system. If not, the governmentality might include a slightly broader range than typical line ministries, but at least governmentality. At least this is a way in which you could imagine the country being governed. Right? So yeah, we're now, do I have, like, if I had a really convincing account of it, I probably would have spoken on that. but we have papers on that, we're doing research on that, we're trying to find examples of how did you get to an effective post office, and how did you get to an effective post office in countries in which other administration isn't working. But what we're trying to avoid is precisely the planner's approach to government, which is what the world, you know, I went to Afghanistan in 2006, visited the World Bank office in Afghanistan in 2006. And hey, what are you guys working on? Well, we're working on defining the civil service pay grades, because what we know Afghanistan needs is a functional government. To have a functional government, has to have a civil service. To have a civil service, you've got to have level 14 and level 15 and level 16, and there's got to be definitions of who's level 14 and who's level 15. We have hired some consultants to come in and help the Afghan government define the characteristics of people in level 14 versus level 15 versus level. And during this period, we're having this conversation in the basement of the World Bank safe house that they can't leave because of security concerns. And you're like, not deck chairs on the Titanic. Umbrellas in the drinks in the cup holders of deck chairs on the Titanic, right? So the planner's approach to big government hasn't worked, but the seeker's approach doesn't necessarily scale. So what we're trying to develop, and like I said, if it were well developed and I was really convincing, I would have been convincing today, maybe on that topic versus raise the problem. But I think that's what has to happen, is there has to be some, we have to have a new theory. I mean, essentially, you know, what was our theory of how countries would come to have effective barbarian bureaucracies? It was, I think Justin, who used to be sitting here, had the best description of it, which is time passes. We really didn't have a theory of it. We thought it was like tadpoles or frogs. It would just happen while we did other things, like focus on economic growth. So we thought economic growth was the hard problem, and the others would take care of themselves. Now, maybe, like Maureen says, a little bit of that happens, but not so much. Okay. Now, why do I not use the word democracy? Well, I don't use the word democracy because I've lived in India. And India has really crappy organizations, really crappy capability of the state, really high levels of corruption. So if we had the view that electoral democracy were, in some sense, the key to all ills, lots of ills of India should be fixed, right? And now, so what I use the phrase responsive polity, which is a deeper, democracy is certainly almost part of that, but it's not the entirety of it. And so I think, and again, this goes back to the same thing, I think the planner approach to development was, let's spend $2 billion for Congo to hold an election. Because we know once they have democracy, things will be better. Well, I believe in a responsive polity, but I believe a responsive polity is democracy plus, 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 and we still have to figure out the plus, plus, plus and how to get there. So that's, can I take two more questions, or are we at the end of time? I mean, Darius left, so.
By that clock, you've got 5 minutes till lunch. So take a couple more questions
okay.
And wrap it up.
I mean, if the guy on the people on the front row are leaving, you know it's about over. Let's take these. Okay, sorry, I'm not going to take yours. I'll answer yours later, but let's take these three because they were there first. No, I changed my mind. Let's take four, and then I'll only answer three. Okay.
Multiple choice. You can answer if you can take them and then just let them hang there.
There you go. Let's take them, though.
My name's Bob Berg. One of the virtues of the MDGs was that it had a legitimating political process.
Absolutely.
A process that was so good that the major donors decided not to have any more UN conferences because otherwise they get more goals, you know.
Right.
We don't have one now. And so I wonder whether you have some thought on that.
Mm. And we don't have a legitimating process.
That's right.
Yeah.
And the second thing that I just wanted to mention, maybe you get a little preview of your book on this, is that we had in 1990 education for all. It was a much better theory than UPE. In 2000, when the education ministers met in Dakar for their Jump TM Plus 10, and I was senior advisor of this meeting, I could not get the education ministers interested in anything other than shrinkage of the goals. So where are the politics for a learning-based education approach?
Well,
Lawrence Chaney from Brookings. Two quick questions. The first one is about this dichotomy between dealing with extreme suffering versus dealing with transformation, full-stage transformation. I think we care about both. The question is, which one should we care about more? And you say that, my understanding is you're saying that one of them matters more, and one of them maybe we could actually be quite good at it, or maybe the other one we're not very bad at it. Can you just tell me whether that's a fair interpretation of what you're saying? And actually, I think you're saying maybe that we're not as good at the extreme suffering as we think, right? So that's another, you know, so it's all relative. The second question is about this framing of the elite to the elite versus the middle of the middle. I didn't quite get that. I had three things I didn't really understand about that. Firstly, that your slide on Canada, I thought that everyone in Canada seems as materialistic as each other, regardless of whether the elite of Canada or the poor of Canada.
Yeah.
The second thing was about where people defecate. In the MDGs has that as a target. It's not just where the poor defecate, it's where everyone does. So that seemed a little bit, that didn't quite fit, I felt. And the third one is about, it comes back to which one do we care about. If we care about extreme suffering, then we care about what the poor of the poor care about. And that presumably is what, you know, Voices of the Poor was about, and it's what sort of the One campaign's effort to try and have the new MDGs be defined by what the poor of the poor care about most. So is the middle of the middle right? Is the middle of the middle only right if we care about state transformation? But if we care about extreme suffering, should we ask what the poor care about? Thanks.
Bob Armstrong, formerly Ford Foundation and World Bank. I was struck on your graph that showed the trend toward post-materialism among the rich countries and how steep it gets, with the United States being one of the richest, but being, as you point out, a great outlier.
Right.
Wonder what you attribute the implications of that, or are there implications for sort of U.S. view of development objectives? Presumably, if we're more materialistic, we would have somewhat more priority for toilets and infrastructure.
Hi, I'm Meredy with Save the Children, working on the post-2015 development framework. And I'm so excited by this presentation, mostly just to see the various counter-arguments really trying to destabilize this discourse that has been kind of a set of assumptions for so long. My question, Save the Children has put forth kind of our vision for post-2015, which is a series of both those human well-being indicators that you talked about, but also some of the rules and system, the institution fixes. So for instance, on the human well-being, ending preventable child deaths, ensuring that all kids are in school and learning. And so my question is, I didn't hear you talk about inequality and closing that gap, and are there risks if we're just improving learning outcomes without actually measuring the gap between kind of the bottom quintile and the top quintile? Or, you know, and if so, would you propose perhaps measuring learning for the bottom 10% of a country and not worrying as much about, you know, just would love to get your thoughts on how to operationalize equality if you think that's important in the framework.
So these are all good questions. and I think, yes, it's kind of a fair characterization. The U.S. has, in fact, been much more sympathetic than, say, the Nordics towards materialist approaches to development. You know, inside the World Bank, after all, who's kind of pushing one sets of issues versus another sets of issues. The U.S. has you really do see the U.S. being more materialist and more sympathetic to materialist concerns, I think. Anyway, but let me address this last question. The key, and this goes to your question simultaneously, because I actually wrote Moving Out of Poverty, which is the sequel to Voices of the Poor, with Deepan Narayan, right? And the thing about Voices of the Poor is if you let the poor define who's poor, they don't say dollar a day. So the dollar a day is a complete construct of elite technocrats. No one self-identifies with it. So, which gets to this question of inequality. I actually think on inequality issues, the rich countries are looking in a mirror and thinking it's a window. I think inequality is a much bigger issue in the United States than it actually is in these other countries, where they recognize that we all are going to rise or sink together, more or less, and kind of, you know, we can worry about reducing inequality, but, you know, the fact of the matter is, if I don't think it's a viable political dynamic in a country in which the elite are getting a crappy education to say we're going to strengthen the public system for the poor and the elite are going to buy their way into private schools. I just don't think that's a viable dynamic. So the kind of question is, how much of inequality reduction is including the poor in a rising tide versus bringing the poor up with a constant level? I think bringing the poor up dramatically with a constant level just is not a politically viable approach. So I'm all for, you know, and I'm all for, you know, it's just like, I guess my overall sense, and it comes back to, even if we accomplish the MDGs, I mean, my way of putting it when the MDGs first came out was, once we get development, the MDGs will be accomplished, but not vice versa. Thanks.
It's left for me just to thank all of you for coming, to congratulate Lant, and to thank Jeff and Brigham Young University, the David M. Kennedy Center, for bringing us this opportunity. I think there's a little bit of breakfast and some stale coffee outside if you want to continue to mingle. Thank you all very much for coming. Congratulations, Lant, and thank you for a wonderful lecture.